She's been called a peerless voice of her generation, writing with honesty and wit about the gratingly ugly truth that's out there. But she does so with a tone that's uniquely hers, presenting you with the truth and why it is so without being disrespectful, but unapologetic as well. Tonight, we get to know the woman behind the words as Talkback talks to New York Times best-selling author, Gia Tolentino.
Come home.
Thank you.
Congratulations on your book, Trick Mirror.
Thanks.
Well, you got what you wanted. You said you're now famous. Well, you got what you wanted because you said you want to be famous for writing a book and not because you're going to be part of a reality TV show. Back on that island in Puerto Rico, was this what you were expecting? Was this what you were talking about?
So, yeah, I didn't even remember saying that to, you know, I was, that essay is about me being on this reality show. I had no recollection of saying that, and that came up as one of the people that I was on the show with was saying that they all came on the show, you know, they all had headshots, they wanted to be actors. I never did. Mm-hmm. I thought that I went on the show because I wanted to skip a month of high school to go be on the beach in Puerto Rico and, you know, drink pina coladas and like flirt with people, right? and then he said this. He was like, I was sitting around at lunch and was like, I don't want to be famous for this. I want to be, if I ever get famous, I want it to be for writing a book. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, it was such a, I was so shocked when he said that because I have no memory of it. Mm-hmm. And I guess, like, I guess I've been pretty consistent, more consistent than I knew.
And you get it. You get the feel of it because when you read it, it's so free.
I'm so glad it feels like that.
It wasn't contrived at all. But when was it that you really found your voice in writing?
I have always, ever since I was little, like I was, you know, like I think all kids that I read constantly, I still read constantly, and I always wrote too. Like ever since I was in elementary school, I would fill up notebooks with, you know, notes and stories and all this stuff. And I think I started to become conscious in like high school and college that writing was a thing that I liked. Like I really liked it, and I did it all the time no matter what. Mm-hmm. Started keeping a journal, but you know, just I would just write compulsively all the time.
In the book, you write about identity and self-delusion and how one can be the other depending on that self and that delusion. But in Pure Heroines, you write about that Power Ranger standoff that you had with your friend, that it marked either the beginning of a period of self-delusion or the end of one. When you look at your success now, how much of what you've attained was fueled by your search and stand for your identity? And how much of it do you owe to self-delusion?
I think that to be a writer, I mean, so yeah, the book is about self-delusion, but I think, you know, to some degree, self-delusion in itself is not, it's not necessarily a bad thing.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Like it's like there's a self that we want to be and we often have to project ourselves into that self. Like we, and even to, you know, I think that to be human and to work is you have to believe that what you're doing matters. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's not necessarily true, right? Like what we're doing on a day-to-day basis, maybe none of it matters. Mm-hmm. But we have to believe it does so that we can do it consciously and like with our full heart, right? And to be a writer, I think it's necessarily involves self-delusion. You have to think that like what you have to say is important enough that people should listen.
Because otherwise, why would
you do it? Because otherwise,
why
would you do it, right? And I think that that impulse is something that I try to monitor in myself because it's not necessarily healthy. Like the whole internet is based on the idea that like anything that anyone has to say is interesting to everyone, and we know that's not true, mm-hmm. right? And we know it's actively kind of harmful in some ways, right? Like this limitless self-expression on the internet is not necessarily a good thing, even though it can be. Anyway, so I think that certainly to think that anyone, that there's a purpose to even writing down what you think. I think that's like a little bit of a, you know, that itself might be a self-delusion at the same time that it's the center of what I do all day long.
Right.
But I've still always had that ever since I was little. Maybe I'm just writing for myself. Mm-hmm. In terms of a search for your identity, I think that, I don't know if it's been any stronger in me than it is for any of us, you know? I think that like the process of being alive is finding out who you are, how you fit into a community, what you're good at, what you're bad at, what you're meant to do, what you're meant not to do. Mm-hmm. I think that like so many of all of our decisions are governed by just figuring out ourselves, right? Mm. And for me, it's just manifested in a particular way.
Mm. All right, now being a child of Filipino immigrants,
yeah.
What did that mean to you when you were beginning, and what does that mean to you now? Now that you're called a New York Times best-selling author, mm-hmm. What does that mean to you?
Well, my uncle, when I went back to Houston, I grew up in Houston, Texas, and my community growing up was very, very white in a way that I write about in the book, like a way that formed me in ways that I don't like. Like, I don't think, I in part regret that I grew up, I was, you know, at this private school in Texas that was mostly white, and I sometimes wish that my life hadn't been like that. You know, I come back here and I'm like, I wish I spoke Tagalog, you know?
Yeah.
I wish that I had had a less white upbringing, and at the same time that I understand, like kind of painfully, what that gave me, which was, I think, like a productive sense of entitlement, like I deserve to be here.
A productive sense of entitlement.
You know, like I was conscious of that even as a high schooler, like I was like, telling myself, like, I hope you can get the good parts of this without the bad parts, right? I hope you can get this sense that you deserve to be here.
Where did you get that? Did you get that from your parents? Did you get that from some other source of influence? Or was it you trying to raise yourself?
Well, I think part of it was my environment. Part of it was kids that were so privileged that they knew they belonged everywhere. Mm. Part of it was definitely the way my parents raised me. They raised me to be very confident. I think I was like that as a kid anyway. Like, yeah. I think I was just one of those kids that like was not really afraid of anything and just did things. And they were very careful to do that. But I think, specifically like being a child of Filipino immigrants, what it taught me is something really particular about America, where it taught me that you could benefit from and be punished by a system at the same time. Where in America, with its long history of anti-black racism, mm-hmm. when you're Asian, mm-hmm. you benefit from racism at the same time that you're punished by it. Mm-hmm. And that it was a really early education in power and how complicated power is and how it can affect you in different ways. Mm-hmm. And I think that so much of what it feels like to be alive right now is to benefit from systems that also punish you. Mm-hmm. And the earliest way I learned that was my own identity, I think.
It gave you a broader sense of reality.
Yeah.
Good and bad.
Yeah.
You took it all in. Now, what do you think draws people to your writing?
I don't know.
Really, when you think about it.
I mean, well, I was saying, I think there are a couple. I have thought about this recently, and I think that, I mean, I do try really, really hard not to waste anyone's time. But I think that, I write a lot about capitalism.
Yes.
And I write a lot about how capitalism has advanced to mm-hmm. a stage that is basically untenable. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that is basically thrumming underneath our discourse and our politics and everything. Like, I think that I write a lot about institutional instability, mm-hmm. and I have come to discover that that is something that basically all of us are thinking about. That's something that's keeping all of us up at night. And I do think that the one thing that I have learned that I am good at doing, I never think that I'm writing anything particularly new, mm-hmm. but I think I am good at picking up on things that a lot of people are thinking.
Right.
And just saying them clearly. Like, I never think that I have original thoughts, but I think I'm good at being clear.
Because it's, you know, I've heard this said about your writing, that it's like reading your own thoughts.
I love it when people say that. I feel really, it's really amazing. I find it really wonderful when people say, like, to me, that is one of the most rewarding things that anyone could ever think, is like, I've had this thought. I haven't known how to say it.
Right.
This helped me.
So you heard it yourself.
People have said that to me, and it's like an incredible gift to mm-hmm. know that people have had that reaction. It's like a real honor.
Conversely, though, there are some people who get repelled.
Oh, sure.
And what do you think about that?
Oh, that's fine. Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm sure you know how it is. It's like when you're a journalist, when you work in public, there are always going to be people that hate your work and don't like you. And And I mean, for me, like, because I've always worked on the internet, because I'm so used to the possibility that a stranger will land in my email and be like, I hate you and think you're stupid. Mm-hmm. I'm like, that's fine. I don't know you. Like, you know, it's like if my friend said that to me, then it would matter. And maybe I would think about, maybe I need to change something. But it's like, I feel like one of the most important things that you can learn as someone whose work is public in any way is that a stranger's opinion of you is none of your business. Mm-hmm. Good or bad, really. Like, you know, it's kind of none of your business.
When you hear, though, that you're the peerless voice of your generation, how does that make you feel?
I think it's incredibly flattering and it's really wonderful. But I think that I think that, you know, just as the internet, just as like mechanisms of kind of self-surveillance and performance, they can make you, like, they can make you feel like you should care too much about hate. Mm-hmm. They can also make you feel like you should care too much about praise.
Correct.
And I try not to get too invested in either. Like, right, like to me, what I care about is writing well, and I care about what it feels like to be able to figure something out in my own brain. Mm-hmm. And I have always felt that if I listen too closely to negative or positive opinions of my work, it could get in the way of that. Mm-hmm. So I try not to, like, it's, I try to like take a little bit of the wonderful part and like,
that's it.
Mostly not, you know, mostly not let it like, let that be my opinion of myself, you know, because that's certainly not it.
Because
you know?
It must fuel you in some way, right?
It is
but
really
not
wonderful
to that extreme extent.
It is really wonderful to know. I think for so many writers, you work so hard and you're not sure if you're going to be if anyone's ever going to read it.
Yeah.
And I don't have to worry about that anymore, and that's wonderful. But the thing about writing is, you can all no matter even if you did it well in the past, every time you sit down to write, you could be horrible.
Right.
You have to work really, really hard not to waste anyone's time, you know? And I think that once writers start believing that they're good and they're always gonna be good, that's when you start writing badly. So I think I'm fueled by that insofar as like, you better live up to it the next time, like you better not get lazy, you know?
There's some sort of guilt that you created a time capsule of what people are calling the worst decade yet.
Yeah.
Because you were a part of it.
Yeah, oh, guilt, no.
No.
No, because I didn't make it the worst decade yet.
But that you were able to, like, put it down to writing.
But I mean, if you're making a time...
You're going to remind them forever.
Yeah, but someone's got to, you know? And you know, I actually, like, I would be honored if people are reading this book, you know, later on. But I've never thought about that. That doesn't really matter to me. Like, truly, what drives me is the feeling of writing itself. That's basically it, you know? Like, the fact that anyone's even reading it now feels like extra. Like, I never think about the future. Yeah.
No, you write about a host of topics. A lot of them about feminism, the internet, in your essays, music to TV shows and movies. What is that one topic that you would never, ever touch?
Oh, that's interesting. I mean, basically, I write about anything that I'm interested enough in to talk to someone about in real life. Okay. And that's and most of the world I'm interested enough in to talk to someone about in real life. Honestly, would never write about. One thing that I haven't been writing about much lately is like, and I know there's a version, there's got to be a version of this in the Philippines where like, I can't do any more of the like, Trump is bad and here's why.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's so boring. Like, we know he's horrible, we know he's racist, we know he's stupid, we know he can barely read, like we know he's destroying. But it's like, to say it again, I have lost the ability to write about him in a way that I find useful.
Here's the thing though, he's not alone. There's that rise of strong arm politicians
exactly,
in the
yeah.
world arena. So
yeah,
what do you
yeah,
think
yeah.
about that?
Well, I think, I mean, a lot of what I write about in the book is about how, like, you know, about how the internet is really intertwining itself. Like, I think that the rise of, like, the dictatorial right all over the world, right, in Hungary and here, Brazil, America, there's a reason it's happening all at once, and it's partly because, it's because the internet allows for a lot of misinformation. And it, you know, it's because we, so much of our lives is routed around tech companies that can only make money if they continually inflame our emotions. and the end result is a super adversarial liar, you know, like that, that's sort of an inevitable type of person that the internet will fuel. I think there's also been a thing lately where like the world has become more connected, more equal, and also more in a state of crisis in the last 10 years, and there's this sort of retaliatory response. Mm-hmm. That is interesting to me. Trump himself, though, you know, like, it's not, yeah.
So, they're telling us we're running out of time. I want to ask you this final question.
Yeah.
So you have just created a time capsule of the worst decade yet. A decade from now, Gia, what do you think you'll be writing about?
So one of the strongest and strangest things about me is that I almost never think about the future. because to me, like, I want to, like, I live very, very much in the now, like the promise of the now, the crisis of the now, the anxiety, the fear, and the hope of the now. Because to me, like, I think part of maybe growing up in this generation, the future is unstable, and to me it feels a little opaque. And I also try in my personal life to have very low expectations so that I'm always happy, mm-hmm. you know? I hope that in 10 years, all of these structures, all of these institutions that seem to be failing, I hope that we've found a way to reinvest in collective well-being. You know, like, I hope that I'm writing about, you know, a global climate accord that capped carbon emissions and suddenly children feel like they have a future in which to live. You know, like, I hope that's what it is. Like, I hope that it's positive lessons from the last decade when I'm, you know, God, thinking about writing in 2029. But I don't know, you know, I don't know.
Well, I hope to read about you. I hope to still read you 10 years from now, but I do hope that it won't take that long for the next book.
Oh, thanks.
Congratulations again, and
thank you so much
for joining us. I appreciate you taking time out to talk to us. Thanks again, and congratulations.